Hey guys, RanterInShades here, exercising my First Amendment Rights vlog style. And as you guys probably know, I'm a major fan of glam metal. You've seen the Poison poster and the Guns N' Roses poster, and you've seen me wear shirts from bands such as Poison, Firehouse, Danger Danger, Striper, Extreme, and others in numerous videos. So it should be kind of obvious at this point. I'm kind of a genius about this genre. I'm at that point where if you name any band, and I literally mean just about any band, I've probably heard of them. This video is going to showcase a few of my favorite obscure glam bands from the late 80s and early 90s that I wish more people knew about. Now, why is that? Why are these bands so great, yet hardly anyone who isn't a big fan of glam knows about them? Well, it was the late 80s and early 90s, and shit was changing. Thanks to the big success of Poison, Guns N' Roses, and Bon Jovi, pretty much every major record label in America was searching high and low for a band that could be the next Poison, or the next Bon Jovi, or the next GNR, and only so many bands were really able to reach anything close to that type of success. You had Skid Row, who were probably the biggest. You had Warrant, Winger, White Lion, Extreme, Slaughter, and my favorite, Firehouse, out of a plethora of bands out at the time. Out of all of that, these are probably the bands people remember most. Maybe. How did I come across the bands I'm gonna go over on this list? Call me a new fag, but I have the good old internet to thank for supplying me with this knowledge I was in such thirst for at the time. That and this book with this cover, I'm sure we've all seen on the internet if you search hair metal on Google Images. Ironically, I found this book in Seattle. Weird, huh? This list is gonna go over 15 bands I really feel sounded great and had potential to be pretty huge had timing worked more in their favor and labels put more into promoting the bands. Definitely check out any of these bands if you like what you hear. Try to get a hold of any of these on Amazon, or if you must, search for a download link or a torrent, since these are kinda out of print. Let's begin. Number 15 is a tie between Bow Nasty and Heaven's Edge. Both of these bands had pretty awesome sounds. If you remember my favorite power ballads video, I included a song by Bow Nasty, one of the ballads from their 1989 album Dirty But Well Dressed, Make a Wish. That song, along with Shake It, Gimme Lovin', the title track Dirty But Well Dressed, Paradise in the Sand, and their cover of Love Potion No. 9 by Lieber and Staller are the standouts on the album. Bow Nasty were very guitar-centered. They have some of the coolest guitar parts I've heard in this style. The drumming is also pretty cool, considering their drummer, Mike Tirana, went on to drum for some pretty high-profile power metal bands, so you know he's got chops. Heaven's Edge, like Bow Nasty, only ended up releasing one album in their heyday. Their follow-up wouldn't end up getting released until 1999. But their self-titled album from 1990 is a very nice melodic album. Nice vocals from Mark Evans, and great guitar work from Reggie Wu. At times I can't stop listening to Find Another Way, which is my favorite of theirs. Had this been from a couple years earlier, I'm sure Heaven's Edge would have been pretty big. Number 14 is King of the Hill. Yes indeed, this band predates Hank. Not sure how they came up with the idea of having it all be one word, but whatever. King of the Hill were pretty similar to Extreme in the sense that they knew how to write some funky shit. The only thing was that Jimmy Griffin was no Nuno Bettencourt. But other than that, the funk is very prevalent in the execution. Like Heaven's Edge, they only released one self-titled album in 1991, and their other release would be shelved for years. But if you're into funky metal, you'll dig songs like I Do You, Freak Show, and Electric Rot, among the other tracks on the album. Number 13 is Bad for Good. Bad for Good are considered metal's boy band. There were four teenagers ranging from ages 12 to 16 and were mentored by none other than Steve Vai, who helped write and produce their sole 1992 album, Refugee. You listen to the songs here and you have a hard time grasping the fact that these are kids. The vocalist is Danny Cooksey, who was an actor on the show Different Strokes and had a small role in Terminator 2. You hear him and he sounds like a grown man. The guitar player, Thomas McRocklin, is also crazy. You hear all these solos and you have a hard time believing this is a kid. Bad for Good was signed to Interscope Records, but they could only do so much to market these kids. After the band fell apart, Danny Cooksey would go on to have such notable voice acting roles as Stoop Kid on Hey Arnold. Yeah, this is the guy. The drummer was Brooks Wackerman, who went on to drum for such bands as Tenacious D, bad religion, and suicidal tendencies. My favorite tracks on their album are Tire Kickin' and Making Me Nervous, their cover of 19 by Phil Lynott, Bangin' Time Again, and We're Gonna Fight. Number 12 is Bad Moon Rising. Of course, they got their name from the classic Creedence Clearwater Revival song. This was a band that had a pretty rich sound. I originally came upon this band because one of my favorite guitarists, Doug Aldrich, was part of this band. Before he went on to play in Dio and Whitesnake, he played in such bands as this, as well as Hurricane and Lion. The sound on here blows me away. Their self-titled debut from 1991 is full of very well-written material such as Full Moon Fever, One Night in Tokyo, and Built for Speed. And Aldrich just kills on this album. I'm so glad he went on to become a more well-known name as far as guitarists go. Number 11 is The Scream. The only chance anybody has heard of this band is if you are a huge diehard fan of either Motley Crue or Racer X. This band featured John Corabi on vocals, who would later join Motley Crue in the 90s, and guitarist Bruce Boilett, along with bassist John Aldrich, who were both members of Racer X and played on their 1987 album Second Heat. The Scream were a bluesy affair who could put together some nicely executed material. My favorite tracks off of their one album, 1991's Let It Scream, are Outlaw, I Believe in Me, Tell Me Why, I Don't Care, and Every Inch a Woman. The band would have probably lasted a little longer, but John Corabi was given the offer to join Motley Crue and replace Vince Neil, and you're not gonna turn down that opportunity. Number 10 is Dirty Rhythm. Dirty Rhythm have what I consider the prototypical glam sound, which is something I'm a sucker for. They remind me a lot of Skid Row and Dokken, which makes for a pretty cool sound. Jeffrey Bonds, the vocalist, is quite talented, and Brian Harrison, the guitarist, is quite skilled. Believe it or not, this band has a tie to thrash metal. Their bassist, Anthony Greenham, played guitar on Annihilator's first album, Alice in Hell. Dirty Rhythm only released one album in 1991 called Hard as a Rock before disbanding. My favorite tracks from the album are Feel the Fire, Hot and Cold, the title track, Hard as a Rock, and One Summer Night. Number 9 is Shotgun Messiah. If you're a fan of Marilyn Manson or KMFDM, maybe you've heard of this band from Sweden. This band featured Tim Skold, who played bass on Shotgun Messiah's 1989 debut and sang vocals on their 1991 follow-up Second Coming. Harry K. Cody, the guitarist, is fucking brilliant. The guitar playing is so insane. You hear songs like Heartbreak Boulevard, The Explorer, Don't Care About Nothing, Sex, Drugs, Rock and Roll, and more, and you're like, damn. Shotgun Messiah's sound kind of varies. On their first album, they sound a lot dirtier, a la Rat, but on their second album, they sound a lot more clean. That kind of confused folks at the time, so maybe that's why they never really caught on. After those two albums, Skold and Coey took the band in a more industrial direction on their 1993 album called Violent New Breed. Skold would continue down the industrial path playing in KMFDM and Marilyn Manson. What I want to know is what the hell Harry K. Cody is up to. Number 8 is South Gang. If there was ever a band you really thought would bring in mega bank but failed, it would be South Gang. Look at them! Don't they look adorable? Don't they look like the kind of guys girls would throw themselves at in the 80s? They do, right? And they had Desmond Child writing their big single, Tainted Angel. Desmond fucking Child! He wrote Bon Jovi's biggest hits, Aerosmith's big 80s hits, Kiss's big 80s hits. What do they got to lose? It was 1991 when their first album, Tainted Angel, came out, and it failed to sell. You hear the sound, and it sounds a lot like Warrant. You're like, shit, man, how did this not go fucking platinum? Fucking grunge, man. The singer, Jesse Hart, has a really cool voice, and on guitar, believe it or not, that's Butch Walker, who went on to have a successful production career producing for a shit ton of pop and alternative pop punk acts. The songs were great on both of South Gang's albums. I lean more towards Tainted Angel, although Group Therapy, their 1992 follow-up, is also quite heavy. My favorites from them are Tainted Angel, Boys Night Out, Russian Roulette, and She's Danger, Seven Hills Saloon. After South Gang fell apart, the band, minus Jesse Hart, would be in two bands. The first one is a funky hard rock band by the name of Floyd's Funk Revival, and I was able to find a download link of the album they released somewhere. And the other band that they were a part of, the more notable band, was a late 90s alternative pop punk act by the name of Marvelous Three, and they had a minor hit with the song Freak of the Week. I spend a lot on all the clothes that I got, cause all the geeks that I meet, they all look cooler than me. But what to do when they're all looking at you, cause you're the freak of the week, cause you're on the TV. Hey, make me a promise. Number 7 is Hardline. Now this is a band that had a big sound. The most noteworthy thing about this band is that Neil Sean of Journey, one of my favorite guitarists, played on their first album, 1992's Double Eclipse. The drummer, Dean Castronovo, who had previously played with Tony McAlpine, Cacophony, Marty Friedman, and Bad English with Neil Sean, would actually go on to be a part of Journey to this day. The sound on here, in my honest opinion, blows Journey out of the water. It's so well produced. Now, I love Journey as much as the next guy, but holy crap, Hardline sounds beautiful. And Neil Sean really shows his chops here on songs like Rhythm from a Red Car, Life's a Bitch, and Taking Me Down. Despite having a big name like Neil Sean involved, the album didn't bring in the big bucks and Hardline disbanded. They did reform a few times, but Neil Sean was not a part of it. Just too busy playing Don't Stop Believin' over and over again, I guess. Whatever makes him money. Johnny Joelli, the singer, with a really superb voice, also went on to sing for Axel Rudy Pell, as well as Crush 40. Number 6 is Trouble Tribe. This band is pretty cool. They have some pretty well-written material and some really nice parts. The musicians are quite well-rounded. The guitar parts are cool, I can actually hear some really interesting bass parts, and the drumming is spot-on. What's kind of disappointing is that there's no biography of the band anywhere on the internet. All I know is that they put out one album, their self-titled album from 1990. My favorite tracks from Trouble Tribe are Tattoo, Give Me Something Sweet, Back to the Well, Red Light Zone, Angel with the Devil's Kiss, and Here Comes Trouble. They also have a nice power ballad cover of Dear Prudence by the Beatles. I'm not into too many Beatles covers, but theirs is exceptional. So is Silverstein's cover of Help. That doesn't really have anything to do with this video, but I'm just saying it kicks ass. Number 5 is Bangalore Choir. This was another fantastically produced band. They were formed by David Reese, who previously sang on Accept's really poorly received album, Eat the Heat. The sound is highly melodic and flirts a bit with AOR. Kurt Mitchell and John Kirk are both excellent players. On bass and drums are Ian Mayo and Jackie Ramos, who had previously played together in Hurricane Alice, a band that almost made this list, as well as, previously discussed in this video, Bad Moon Rising. This was another case of bad timing and lack of promotion, but this could have really gone places. Max Norman did a fantastic job producing their 1992 album On Target. My favorite tracks are Angel in Black, Just One Night, Loaded Gun, Slipping Away, and Doing the Dance, which was co-written by Jon Bon Jovi. In 2010, Reese and Mitchell actually reunited and brought in some new members and have released two new albums since then. Number 4 is Saints and Sinners. Here we have a band from Canada that was formed by vocalist Rick Hughes of a little-known metal band called Sword, not to be confused with The Sword. Hughes got a nice group of Canadian musicians together and had their sole 1992 self-titled album produced by fellow Canadian Aldo Nova. I guess he's a big name in Canada. He only had one really big hit with Fantasy in 1981. The production is very glam and sounds awesome. Stéphane Dufour, the guitarist, is truly exceptional. He has actually released some solo stuff I've managed to get a hold of. He's just that good, enough to make me seek out more. My favorite tracks from their 1992 self-titled are Shake, Rip It Up, Walk That Walk, Wheels of Fire, and the really long and epic Frankenstein. Frankenstein should really be the thing to sell you on the true abilities of glam metal musicians, so I will link a video of that song in the description. Number 3 is Heavy Bones. Heavy Bones was a very short-lived supergroup featuring Joel Ellis, one of the most criminally underrated vocalists of a bluesy glam group called Cats in Boots, Gary Hoey, one of my favorite virtuoso guitarists, Frankie Benali of Quiet Riot and Wasp, and a guy named Rex Tennyson from the band Hellion on bass. They had a sound that reminds me of if Motley Crue were more melodic. They, like Saints and Sinners, released one self-titled album in 1992. It was produced by Richie Zito, and it's damn heavy. Joel Ellis does a fantastic job on vocals with his high-pitched, Vince Neil-sounding rasp, and Gary Hoey's playing is simply amazing. There's actually a song that has a 7/8 part that I played on drums as part of my college audition. That song, which is called 4AM TM, along with The Hand That Feeds, Turn It On, Where the Living Is Easy, and Where Eagles Fly are my favorites. Where Eagles Fly actually has a great acoustic part for the first half of the song, and it builds up to such a heavy blast with an awesome progression before Hoey's solo. It's a masterpiece. Number two is Wildside. Now here's a band that really had what it took. Anyone who's heard their 1992 debut Under the Influence will tell you that it's an underrated classic. They got signed to Capitol Records, and according to their Facebook, they actually have an active page, they got a 7-album, $2.1 million deal. This is one of the biggest Hollywood rock signings since Wasp in 1984. Not only that, they got Andy Johns, who had produced for Humble Pie, Free, Rod Stewart, MSG, and Cinderella, and engineered for Jethro Tull, Blind Faith, and... drumroll please. The Rolling Stones and Led Zeppelin, producing for them. Wildside should have been huge with all of this factoring in. It's a mystery to this day. What else, apart from it being 1992, could have gone wrong? It's hard to say what Wildside's sound could compare to. It's the kind of sound where you hear it and it just sounds like the glammiest of glam. I guess they sound a little like Britney Fox meets LA Guns, in the sense that it's crazy yet controlled, and comes out sounding awesome. Wildside did release a follow-up in 1995, but it was such a disappointment that the band themselves disregarded that album. It's one of those albums that shows the band trying to jump on the grunge bandwagon, so it's no surprise it's universally disliked. My favorites from Under the Influence are Hang On Lucy, So Far Away, Monkey See Monkey Do, Hair of the Dog, which is not a cover of Nazareth, and Heart and Soul, which is not a cover of T'Pau. Before we get to number one, I'm going to have a little montage of bands that I didn't think were as obscure to make the cut, but I still recommend you look into them if you like what you hear.
Shit!
and my number one favorite glam metal band that you've never heard of is Roxy Blue. Oh, Roxy Blue. Now, why did they not catch on? I mean, they were signed to Geffen Records, had Mike Klink, who had scored big producing Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction, producing their one and only album, Want Some, with that really lovely cover. They had a sound that was reminiscent of Poison and Warned with Eddie Van Halen-style guitar playing. How could this have failed? Like most of the bands we've discussed in this video, their album was released in 1992. The labels gave that much of a shit about these bands at the time, and that's what's so unfortunate. I've told 16 stories in this video about bands that oozed potential that ended up getting fucked. Roxy Blue for me is a sad story for this. The biggest tour they did was opening for Spinal Tap, when they decided to give the band another shot and came out with Break Like the Wind. They, in turn, were basically opening for a biopic of Freddie Mercury. How sad is that? Again, the sound Roxy Blue had on their album was just great. Todd Poole had a nice Bret Michaels-like voice, and Sid Fletcher is just awesome with his playing. My favorite tracks of theirs are Rob the Cradle, It's So Easy, Main Attraction, their cover of The Who's Squeezebox, which has a mind-blowing solo, and even the two ballads, Times Are Changing and Nobody Knows, are well done. Want Some is an album I view as an underrated masterpiece, as far as glam goes. Todd Poole did go on to have some success playing drums on Saliva's first album, but that was the biggest he really got. You know what Sid Fletcher went on to become? A dentist. That's pretty heartbreaking. But hey, that doesn't change the fact that Roxy Blue had a nice run and released a great album. And that concludes my list of the best glam metal bands you've never heard of. Hopefully this got you interested in checking any of these bands out. Thank you for watching this video, take care, and have a nice day. I'm Shades, and I'll see you next time.